We have a lot of victories that we got for the domestic workers. Domestic workers are covered under the National Minimum Wages Order that makes provision for a national minimum wage and overtime pay and pay for public holidays. We're not sure if they're getting all that, but that is a violation of the Minimum Wages Order, and you could carry issues like that to the Ministry of Labor and the Industrial Court. And that couldn't happen without the National Union of Domestic Employees, because we fought and won the right to carry cases of non-compliance of the Minimum Wages Order to the Industrial Court. All these victories we have, but our burning issue remains the same. We want the inclusion of domestic workers under the definition of worker under the Industrial Relations Act. We want it, and we want it bad. Because when that has happened, it will undermine all the other discrimination that domestic workers have to face. We also want Convention 189 on decent work for domestic workers. And after coming into force in September 2012, and even though our government sits on the governing body, they still refuse to ratify the convention. So, and then we have CEDAW, the convention, the Committee on Elimination of Discrimination Against Women, telling Trinidad and Tobago government to include domestic as workers under the IRA. And the committee is also spoke about providing remedies in the workplace for victim of sexual harassment. A lot of that going on in the workplace. And I don't think it's only alone in the trade union movement knows about gender and interested and have a passion to ensure that women come up as equal as men within the workplace. And we want to see some kind of equity. We want to see gender mainstreaming within the trade union movement. That is what we want to see, you know? And some women, I am happy to tell you, in the trade union movement now are really taking on that issue of gender. We haven't come out as yet, Ryan, but soon.
You do not understand development if you do not understand gender. That's what I heard earlier today. And it's a powerful statement. And I want to use that as a sort of launching pad to have or to share our experience. You see, I want to suggest that we also do not understand the history of our region if we do not understand the nature and character of exploitation. Where I want to take off is really what is the experience of the trade union movement and civil society organizations in challenging those structures. Trade unions and civil society policy advocacy. I say it has to be transformational advocacy. It has to be a future where we rethink our Caribbean. We have to ask ourselves then, how do we continue to challenge the current political and economic structures that continually perpetuate the inequality and unjust nature of our states? We have made critical attempts to bring those pieces back together to form and establish a social movement once again to continue the unfinished project of bringing true liberation to the Caribbean.
And so that really is it. How do we transform the structures ultimately so that what we did resulted in what we at Trinidad and Tobago are calling the Second Republic, the need for a Second Republic. Mm-hmm. The First Republic has failed, Trinidad and Tobago, our post-colonial institutions have failed to deliver upon a decent quality of life for all of our citizens and so on, and a fair and equitable distribution of the wealth that is generated from the labor that men and women do every day. And therefore, how do we create a new economic and political system? It's not an easy process. People have made advances and then they get reversed, as happened in Brazil and Venezuela and so on. So it's a complex question which requires a lot of thought and so on, but we do need to do that. Otherwise, the advocacy is going to be the same discussion 25 years from now.
So I started to try to understand, and to me, this work that we are doing here is really political work. But how I am able to work here is different to abroad. Like if I go to England and meet with people like Selma James, because there is where I go for my training, because they are radical women, you know? And there where you meet with women, lesbian, gay, and I mix around them and I could go with them and advocate for things. When I'm there, even I have to go out there and meet with sex workers and encourage them to come to meetings, so that we started to do all this talk about sex workers here in Trinidad, and the members nearly kill us. You understand? How will we raise the awareness with grassroots people on the ground to let them understand that all these issues, it pertains to people, and it's people who are workers. And to me, a trade union, I always know, we have to pick up all the issues. And that is the way. So how are we going to change the mindset of people here? That you could, a trade unionist could talk about, advocate for the sex workers, you know, and don't feel no way. Or even LGBT and things like that. How are we going to change these people's behavior towards the own kind, you have to see?
What is to be done? One, we have to recognize and appreciate our historical value. You see, the Grenadian Revolution, we mustn't be ashamed of these things anymore. The Grenadian Revolution means something to us. The work of Walter Rodney, the work of C.L.R. James, Frantz Fanon, and the list can go on. We have to reconnect to that, because that meant something to us. Two, we need to break down the barriers that separate us. We need to break down the barrier that room and street have to come together. We can't do it in the room alone, neither can we do it on the streets alone. We need to reconnect the rooms with the streets. C.L.R. James once said, power lies in the streets, and we must never, ever forget that. We must also, a very key point, solidarity, not just in statements, but in action. We know solidarity, I think, more than any other region in the entire world. We need to go back to those roots. Three, we need to be real and identify the real and present danger with the rise of fascism and the consolidation of neoliberalism. We must no longer, somehow I feel like sometimes we're afraid to even say neoliberalism. What is happening in Grenada, that's what it is. What is happening in Antigua, Barbados, Trinidad and Tobago, Guadeloupe, Martinique, what do you think is one enemy? Neoliberalism. You see, before, we were clear who our enemy was. It was the plantation owners, estate owners. Later on, it became the colonials. It became London. But when we became independent, we kind of lose focus. Somehow, we're not sure who it is, so we kind of start to turn on each other. We need to reevaluate, because we have an enemy. I think we need to stop pretending that we don't. We have an enemy, and I'm suggesting it is neoliberalism. We can never defeat patriarchy and gender inequality in a neoliberal world. Never. My fourth and final comment is more of a hopeful one. We have to, as a region, we have to join the fight back. Do not for 1 minute think that there aren't others who are fighting back. We as a region, especially since we as a region once led, we were at the forefront in the challenging of the global inequality in the 30s and so on. We need to reassert our position in that global fight back. And there are two concrete opportunities. We need to strengthen the assembly of Caribbean people in a real way. We need to have such an assembly of civil society, and trade unions to build a regional social movement to advance the interest of ordinary Caribbean people. And we have the ALBA social movements across the Americas trying to reorganize themselves in light of the attacks by the neoliberals right in this moment. We in the region have to join that fight back. And that is my proposal in terms of what is to be done. Those are my four concrete suggestions. Thank you.